To enter the community of Hopkins was for me a revolution in my life. I was accepted. I was an innocent, wet behind the ears boy from the country in Virginia. I knew virtually nothing. I had a pretty good education in some things, but not so good in science. And I was accepted by the great teachers of Hopkins as an equal person, as a scholar, as a student, to explore these things together. And the collegiality of Hopkins is a very snooty place, you know. It thinks it's hot. It thinks it's very good. But that has a wonderful effect on young people because it makes you realize that you must live up to something. It gives you an ideal to work towards. And that was a very important thing in my life. The teachers in the basic science departments were absolutely wonderful. And the Department of Anatomy was filled with world-class scholars like Marion Hines and Sarah Tower and Bill Strauss and Lewis Weed and Lou Flexner. And all those people taught us every day, person to person, at the desk. So that had a pretty tremendous impact on me. And that feeling of collegiality at Hopkins persisted through all my years here. I've been here since 1938, with 3 years out during the war. And I can tell you that quite honestly, in all those years, not a single person has ever aggressed me in any way, has never competed with me directly for funds or space or appointments. And that is rather unusual, I think, in institutions. And that created a feeling of goodwill. I came into Philip Bard's department. He was a very great man. I'll tell you something about him later. And I knew absolutely nothing. I never did an experiment until my 28th year. I was almost 29. And I began to do things with him and with other people there and began to work. And after I'd been there for 6 months or so, I discovered that my great teachers, at whom I revered so much, like E.K. Marshall and William C. Clark in biochemistry, knew who I was and knew what I was doing. And then I learned something else, which had a tremendous impact on me. All of these people had the idea, or they made me think that they thought I was better than I thought I was. And that's a tremendously wonderful stimulus. The stimulus is come up to us, not put you down. And for me, that has existed all my life at Hopkins, and it's been the major driving force behind my career, to try to live up to what these people expected me to be. And Philip Bard was the epitome of this. In all of my years with him, Philip Bard never uttered a single word of criticism of anything I ever did, only trying to help you. He never changed a word in any paper I wrote, but that meant that I rewrote them several times before I let him see them. And in general, he was a man with a terrific charismatic influence. When you got within about 6 feet of Phil Bard, you began to feel good. And all of us who came within that arena knew it then, and we know it now, that we were in the presence of a man with a tremendous impact on all of us. Not really scientifically. The impact was as a person, and to show you what a man could be in his life. And that impressed all of us very much indeed. Now, when I came into physiology, in the Department of Physiology, it was a little department of neuroscience, actually. There was Phil Bard. There was Clinton Woolsey, who was at the peak of his career of mapping. There was Jersey Rose, a neuroanatomist. There was Reginald Bromley, an experimental psychologist. There was Evelyn Howard, a neuroendocrinologist. And Chandler Brooks, a neurophysiologist, and that was it. And these people were all neuroscientists, but they were charged with teaching all of physiology, which they had to do. The facilities were abysmal. Woolsey had one laboratory with a 3-inch oscilloscope. It was used 7 days a week, night and day, by Woolsey and his students and by the rest of us. I began to work with Phil Bard in lesion work. I realize, looking back on that period now, that it was too early to do that, because there had not developed at that time methods for measuring behavior in monkeys, which came along later in the hands of Harlow and Prebram and some of Mishkin and other great people in that field. Phil Bard's approach was simply descriptive. He was very perceptive at that, but that wasn't good enough. He and I spent several years, for example, trying to dissect the Kluver-Busey syndrome by making differential lesions of the temporal lobes of monkeys. At the same time, I began to work in electrophysiology because the dominant theme on the first floor of the department was Clinton Woolsey. Now, Clinton Woolsey was the father of this, of the whole period of geographic mapping. And he would map anything that walked, and he did most of his life. But that geographic era was very important, although it was, in a sense, not very thrilling. But it laid the base for future physiological experiments. And at that time, he was mapping the cortex. There was a great deal of interest in the dorsal thalamus, largely because of Jersey Rose. And so Elwood Hinman and I decided to map the thalamus. And we began with cats. We were allowed to use the student cats beginning at 5 in the afternoon. Facilities were so poor and money so short, there was no other way. Jersey Rose and Reginald Bromley went to Harvard and spent the summer with Bob Galambos. And they brought back to the Hopkins Laboratory the idea of doing single neuron analysis. We set about trying to develop techniques. We had only low impedance amplifiers, so we had to devise a low impedance input electrode. That shows you how poor we were at that time. But at any rate, Jersey and his colleagues, I should say something about Jersey Rose before we go on. He's a unique person in the history of neuroscience. He was the most critical person I've ever known. If you said your tie was green, he would tell you, no, it isn't red. I did many all-night experiments with Jersey Rose, probably for many years. I would say that I learned more Polish history than any other neuroscientist in America, including his story that all the Jagiellon kings had congenital syphilis. But he also was very funny, very amusing person. The only person I ever knew who could smoke 3 packs of Camels during an all-night experiment. But he and I began to work with the method of single neuron analysis in the dorsal thalamus. We did so because at that time we had no way of stabilizing the pulsations of the cerebral cortex. And that paper, which we worked 5 years on, published in 1954 in the Hopkins Bulletin, a great deal of attention was paid to temporal order, to the sequence with which impulses discharged. And people don't know that paper, but I'm very proud of it, because all of the measurements were done by projected film, measuring the interval between every spike ever recorded during that time. Everyone there worked on the somatic afferent system. We talked about it every day from lunch on. That was a major subject of inquiry. And the map was not very well known. There had been some retrograde and antegrade degeneration experiments which indicated the locus of transfer in the dorsal thalamus, but it was not known very precisely. So we began to do that with the gross electrode recording technique. And there's an interesting anecdote. We were doing it by mapping and then remapping. And one day Clinton Woolsey walked into the laboratory and he said, why don't you listen to it? So we turned on the amplifier and lo and behold, we could hear the brain in action. From then on, we could map very, very rapidly. At each locus, you could map and map out the receptive field projecting to that particular locus in the brain by listening to the responses. It never occurred to us before. So that made it possible to map an entire dorsal thalamus in one experiment. And that was very important because putting together different parts from different experiments was very difficult. At that time, we were not observing the activity of single neurons. And it became quite obvious that there were some major problems. Here was what appeared to be a single topographic representation. Within that, there were several submodalities represented. How are they represented? How are they interdigitated? And beyond that, the most important question for me, which has dominated my thinking during much of my career, is what are the dynamic properties of transmission? And this goes beyond geography. And that's what I think has been actually the most important work that I've ever done, I think, has been on that. So the method of single neuron analysis made that possible. What made it possible to shift to the cortex? A very simple thing. Phil Davies was then a member of the Department of Biophysics here at Homewood, and when Bronk came here, that building wasn't built, so he sequestered these people around in the medical school, and Phil Davies ended up in physiology. He was then working on the circulation of the cerebral cortex, and he had discovered a paper by a different Forbes in 1924, in which the man devised a chamber over the cortex, which stabilized the pulsations of the cortex. And Forbes published a picture at that time, 1924, in which you can see the red cells going through the vessels. Well, we immediately say, aha, this is what we need to record from the cortex. So Davies, with his own hands in the machine shop, built a micro drive fitting on top of a chamber, which would allow us to record from the cerebral cortex and to stabilize its pulsations. Without that, there was not much hope of doing single neuron work in the cerebral cortex. Once that technique was developed, that took a couple of years. Of course, that's not just a joke to pass off. But after that was shown to be effective, Jersey and his friends, his colleagues, began to work on the auditory cortex, which was came from his interest in going to Harvard, and I began to work on the somatic sensory cortex, following my own interest in terms of dynamics and modality segregation. I was working on the somatic sensory cortex, and I was making long penetrations down through the pia and into the cortex, some of them vertically and some of them tangentially on an angle through the cortex. And I began to map or graph all of these results tabulated in order. And I discovered one day when looking at these tabulations that lo and behold, if the penetration went normally to the pial surface and down through the cortex, that every neuron had a certain set of basic properties that was identical. That is, in terms of receptive field and modality type. Whereas if the penetration was passed tangentially through the cortex, these began to change from place to place. So I had this eureka experience of columnar organization. And I have to confess my ignorance. At that time, I had not read Lorenti Deneau's great review of 1947. Lorenti talked about a vertical sets of neurons connected together vertically across the layers. He had no idea that this was discontinuous in the horizontal dimension, but that doesn't matter. It's interesting to think about how this went against the zeitgeist, because even at that time, you know, it was popular amongst particularly psychiatrists to talk about the supragranular layers dealing with psychic functions and infragranular layers with et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And that turns out to be pure nonsense. It isn't true. The cortex isn't organized that way. Well, this idea of columnar organization didn't meet with much approval in the minds of my colleagues. And Jersey Rose tried to persuade me not to publish it, so it's nonsense. And my two colleagues who were on the first paper with me of that 1957 set were somewhat reluctant to have their names on the second paper on columnar organization. So I said, fine, I'll write this myself. And I was very fortunate then to move immediately to the study in the monkey. And those studies in the monkey are much better than the study in the cat. I began those, and when I was along in the monkey experiments with four or five monkeys, a great person named Thomas Powell came to work with me at Johns Hopkins. Powell was a student of Wilfred LeGros Clark, one of the great neuroanatomists of his era. And Powell was an excellent neuroanatomist, and he came with a special point of view. He said to me, I am not coming to become a neurophysiologist. I'm coming so I can understand the neurophysiological literature. So he and I began to work together, and we published four papers. They're in the Johns Hopkins Hospital Bulletin, scarcely known by anyone. Some of the best writing that I've ever done, I think. And the second paper of that series documents columnar organization in the monkey in detail. And the aficionados in the field know those papers, but the casual reader does not. Let me say a little bit more about columnar organization and the motives behind my exploration of that. It was only when we began to work on the monkey that I became really knowledgeable about the afferent innervation of the hand and realized that there are really separate channels from the hand. And as you know, the peripheral fibers innervating the hand are segregated channels terminating peripherally in particular sets of transducers. And these channels enter the brain and ascend it through the dorsal columns and which are shown here, and into the dorsal column nuclei, which are hidden here beneath the cerebellum, and from thence into the ventral basal complex of the thalamus, and from there up to the postcentral gyrus. And these channels are virtually uniquely isolated from each other all the way, with very little overlap in terms of modality, and if there's any overlap in terms of topography, that's dynamically constrained, so that the receptive fields, for example, of cells in the postcentral gyrus are scarcely any larger than those in the dorsal column nuclei. So here's a red-hot system, the Autobahn of the somatic afferent system. What a place to study dynamics. And that's what I set about trying to do. Now, that isolation may be maintained dynamically as well as by anatomical projection specificities. But this meant that within the traditional projection area in the postcentral gyrus, there must be some separate representation of these different modalities from the hand. And indeed, that is what we found. And the one then could come to define columns in terms not only of the peripheral receptive field activating each cell, but but the particular type of modality specificity of the neurons within that particular vertical group. And now, this elaborated later in my own mind and other work in a much, I think, more important way. And that was the idea of the module and distributed systems, which I may come back to a little bit later. But the importance of columnar organization is not just in the vertical organization, but is in modular organization of the cerebral cortex. So it has a generalizing significance, and that's what thrilled me about it. Every scientist wants to discover something that has some generalizing importance. And I believe that the columnar organization and the idea of the modular organization of the brain and distributed systems did so. Now, I was very lucky at that time, because in spite of the fact that so many people disbelieved this, Dave Hubel and Torsten Wiesel did not. And they discovered the same thing in the visual cortex and elaborated it beautifully, as you know, in a whole series of magnificent papers. In fact, I think that their work is probably one of the two or three most important things done in the second half of this century. And then, rapidly thereafter, beautiful work was done on the auditory cortex as well. At that time, when I finished doing the experiments on the postcentral gyrus with Tom Powell and studying columnar organization in the monkey, I thought a great deal about the problems. I had never been very much enamored of the mapping approach. I was really interested in dynamics of the system, and I was able to study that over a period of years from 1960 till 1969 when I started to work on the waking monkey. I consider those the most rewarding years of my scientific life because I was studying things which I thought were the real functioning brain, not just mapping. And I did it with a series of extraordinary postdoctoral fellows, beginning with John Poggio and Gerhard Werner and Kornhuber and Lamotte. And we began with the idea of trying to look at the dynamics of the system. And we began working on the dorsal thalamus for reasons that are rather obscure and we need not go into that now. But then we began with the rotation of joints. We didn't have a good skin stimulator, that's why. But we then pursued that looking at every detail of the discharge pattern, every interval between every impulse. We were trying to discover what was the relevant neural code. It was quite clear that the old idea of just the frequency code isn't enough. And you'll see in those papers some detailed studies of sequential order. And I'll come back to sequential order in a few minutes, because it's now becoming more interesting once again. After that, I was fortunate enough to learn from Gerhard Werner how to dissect peripheral fibers. So I went directly to the monkey hand after some preliminary experiments in the cat and began to study the dynamic patterns of discharge in afferents innervating the monkey skin, the skin of the monkey hand, in response to various types of stimulation. And that was a revelation, because we could compare that directly with the measurements of performance in humans and in monkeys in response to the same stimuli. Now, we were not yet at that time at what I call the combined experiment, which you do these together. We were doing them separately and comparing, doing some cross-species assumption, which we later proved was true, and we could abandon it. But it was an absolutely thrilling time. And we were able to do detailed psychophysics in humans and in monkeys, and to show that the monkey can do with his hand everything you can do with yours. And I'll come back to that in a few minutes. And this led me then into study of the CNS, the postcortical problem, the postcentral gyrus representation of these inputs. And we then were able to train monkeys to detect and to discriminate between stimuli delivered to their hands while we were recording from their postcentral gyrus. And that was the initiation of the combined experiment for me long before the parietal lobe work. And it was an absolutely thrilling time, because we had it in our hands. We could specify exactly what was the input, what was the expected behavioral performance, how did he perform, and compare that to the input and to the postcentral gyrus response. And I think those were my best papers of my life, actually. You know, sometimes investigators think their best work is not what other people think their best work, but I think so. And the reason is that it was a little bit harder science than neurophysiology frequently is, or at least my neurophysiology had been. And I found it very rewarding from that point of view. For example, in studying flutter vibration in the postcentral gyrus, I was able to specify the input from past knowledge of first order fibers and of psychophysics to say that these two stimuli between which I asked the monkey to discriminate between, say, 30 and 32 hertz, these two stimuli are activating the same sets of peripheral fibers and the same cortical neurons. Then I could dismiss the alternative that frequency discrimination is due to a spatial shift. It wasn't. It was due to something intrinsic in the discharge of those cells. And that turned out to be sequential order. It's the one example I know of in which there's clear proof that sequential order, with that is, time intervals between impulses, are critical for the behavioral event. That is, how you discriminate 30 from 32 depends upon the difference in the intervals between impulses. Everybody knows that advances in science depend upon technical advances. And every advance that I've ever made, and particularly this one that you refer to on flutter vibration, depended upon the development of new methods and new techniques. First of all, an adequate skin stimulator, a stimulator with which we could produce indentations of the skin and control at the micron level over a wide frequency range. Techniques for microdissection of peripheral fibers, and techniques for recording from single neurons in the cerebral cortex of the waking monkey. All of those things, I was aided greatly in all of those things by a wonderful group of engineers at the Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Laboratory in Howard County, where there are 1,000 engineers, and they were just anxious to do what they could to help us. And they did. And every sophisticated instrument I ever had in all of my life was designed and built by engineers from the Applied Physics Laboratory, working through our department, our great department of biomedical engineering here at Johns Hopkins. Without that, I could never have made it because you don't have time enough to do it or have the skills to do, for example, to make a micro drive that's so light it weighs only 80 grams, it can be carried on the chamber on the head of the animal. That's an achievement. That's John Chubbuck's stimulator, one of the great contributions. So from the experimenter's point of view, these were so satisfying to me because I had it all in my hands. I could control every aspect of the experiment, like precise control of the stimulus, like precise control of the behavior of the animal. We had to teach ourselves how to train animals. I should say, this will surprise you, but say that in training an animal for an experiment like this, you might spend 2 hours a day with him for 6 months. So the investment in this type of experiment in terms of time is a tremendous thing. And then the analytic techniques that follow the experiment are of extreme importance, and a whole host of people outside and in neurophysiology have contributed to that. I would think particularly of my friend George Gerstein at Pennsylvania, who has spent his life trying to work out how you analyze neural data recorded with microelectrodes, and his contributions are tremendous in that respect, and we've all used them. A number of other people, too, have worked in that, but I think of him particularly. So we had in our hands everything from the control of the stimulus to the analysis of the data we obtained. And that made, from the experimenter's point of view, a very satisfying experiment to do. In these experiments, our form of stimulation was limited to brief indentation of the skin, which could be controlled in terms of slope, depth, duration, or superimposed upon that oscillations of different frequencies and different amplitudes. Some of my colleagues have since then devised even much more complex stimuli, like the stimulators like that by Bob Lamotte at Yale or Rinaldo Romo in Mexico, which allow them to move stimuli across the skin in various ways like this. And Dr. Johnson here in Hopkins has very sophisticated methods of stimulating the skin with letters, having animals identify letters. All of those are two or three steps beyond what I had at that time. But what made it so beautiful for me to study flutter vibration was the stimulus control. We had it in our hands. And that's a very satisfying thing. It approached what the people have been able to do in visual and auditory systems, which are so far ahead of us in terms of stimulus control during most of the years of my experimental life. So that for me was a tremendous step forward. Learning how to train animals to do animal psychophysics and to record from single neurons in the cerebral cortex, And then a tremendous step forward was the development of the multi-microelectrode technique, which we did in collaboration with some wonderful engineers in the University of Marburg in West Germany. And the advantage of that is not only that you look at several neurons from a population, but that you're taking the experiment has increased fantastically. In my last experiment on the motor cortex, I was studying 50 or 60 cells a day. Well, compared to the days when you studied one or two or three, that's quite a step forward. So the advantage of it is, in the somatic system, the problem with inserting a single microelectrode is if you're trying to hit this particular point of the skin, you may be in and out two or three times before you hit it. If you have a grid of electrodes, you're certain to hit it first shot. That's a tremendous advantage in the somatic system. In the visual system, it doesn't matter so much because you're off half a degree, you don't give a hoot, you know, it's the same thing. So it was not only technical advance, but conceptual advance, and particularly the desire on all of us to study dynamic operations in the brain. And this is the thing that I would like to emphasize, because the era of geography, the era of anatomy, we've been dominated by geography and by anatomy now for 50 years. The time has come to do physiology again. And that's coming very rapidly. And the questions are, what do you mean by distributed processing? What do you mean by population coding, et cetera, et cetera? And these things are now open for study with new techniques. How to be young again. Well, the transition in my own scientific life from the study of animals regarded as a preparation and a waking behaving monkey was a very striking one. And it began in the late 1960s, largely due to the stimulation of my friend Edward Everts. He had developed a technique, which was started by Jasper, of recording from the cortex of the waking monkey in the motor cortex. And I visited him on one occasion in, I think, 1968, and saw him doing this experiment. And I left somewhat depressed because I didn't see how we could control the stimuli I delivered to the hand. That was on a Friday. And the next Monday morning, I looked down the hall in my laboratory, and there was Ed Everts striding towards me with that wonderful smile on his face, carrying on his shoulder a box filled with all the gadgets needed to record from the waking monkey. Well, after that, what could I do? So I took it up and developed the waking monkey preparation, working with flutter vibration with a series of young colleagues. That work only published in abstracts, because suddenly something happened. We found, we did a control experiment, sometimes a mistake, you know. We had found that when an animal detected the presence of a vibratory stimulus, there was a beautiful correlation between the entrainment of the neurons in the postcentral gyrus and his detection percentage. Then we did the control of doing the same experiment with the animal not detecting, and we found no difference at all. Well, that of course produced all sorts of ideas, but one day, a sudden day, in the midst of an experiment, seeing this, we decided to move, and we moved the site of penetration over into the inferior parietal lobule. And that day's experiment changed my experimental life for 15 years. Because what we saw there was absolutely startling. We saw neurons of various types, which I'll describe in a moment, but the common property they had was that they discharged if and only if the animal was concerned with the stimulus, if he had a mind to do something with the stimulus. That is, the activity was conditional, not in a Pavlovian sense, but conditional upon his interest in the objects we presented to him. Well, that turned my attention, to the parietal lobe syndrome. Now, I immediately backtracked, and I went to explore, and I did an in-depth scholarly study of everything I could find out about the parietal lobe syndrome, beginning with the cytoarchitecture of the posterior parietal cortex, next particularly in clinical neurology, and the great monograph of McDonald Critchley on the parietal lobe led me into making ward rounds in the hospital and seeing these patients. And I looked up all of the case histories labeled parietal lobe syndrome in the Hopkins Hospital, and I did everything I could to bring myself up to speed in terms of knowledge about the parietal lobe and the defects in behavior which follow its removal. And the parietal lobe syndrome is a very striking one. It is, in a sense, an isolated lesion of consciousness. The subject with the parietal lobe syndrome is ignorant of or ignores the whole contralateral side of space, of his body and of things around him. He denies that he possesses this hand contralateral to his parietal lobe syndrome. And I did a series of experiments making lesions in monkeys and was able to duplicate many of those things, particularly those which we could measure, like the defects in the accuracy of reaching. And because of that, we took up as the first problem in the parietal lobe the study of the reaching neurons. Now, there are two sets of neurons in the parietal lobe that are concerned with reaching, one which is active during the high-speed trajectory of the arm through space, and a second which is active as the subject manipulates an object which has attracted his attention, which he wants. We call them the Winkel neurons, the reach and the Winkel neurons. And we devised an apparatus which was called Vernon's electric train, in which the animal sat in the midst of a race, and around this race objects could be moved that he fixated, detected dimming of the light, and projected his arm. Then we made an interesting observation. We found that when the reach neurons were active in response to detecting a visual stimulus, the same neurons were active when he detected a change in a somatic sensory stimulus delivered to his hand. That was a shocking finding for me. That is, the input didn't matter. What mattered was whether the animal had an interest in the objects he was reaching for. Well, that was one class of neurons. We then went on to study the saccade neurons, which are active when the animal saccaded his eye to an object of interest, but not active during spontaneous saccades as he glanced around the environment. I should have pointed out that the reach and Winkel neurons are inactive as the animal makes casual movements. It's only when he makes a directed movement toward an object of interest in which they are active. And then we spent a long time in studying the various classes of visual neurons. It turns out I was very hesitant to call them visual neurons in the meaning of vision, because I therefore call them, in the beginning, light-sensitive neurons. I still think that's an important fact, because one should realize that every neuron in the nervous system which is activated by light is not necessarily visual in nature. After all, there are spinal cord reflexes evoked by light stimuli. So I was very hesitant to call them visual neurons, but now everybody does call them visual neurons, so I do. And they are extraordinary. They're strikingly different from the visual neurons in the classical visual cortex or in the temporal lobe projections, pre-striate projections of the visual cortex. And they're different in the following way. In the first place, they have huge bilateral receptive fields. That means you have in the parietal lobe an integration of input from the opposite hemisphere. There's no other way you can have a bilateral visual field without that. And the other striking thing about it is that these neurons are oriented for the direction of movement, either inward towards the line of fixation or outward away from it. And then the effect of attention came in. Now, we've studied attention, and many people have studied attention in many ways. It's a very difficult field, because what one sees is the effects of attention. One can never in this way study the mechanism of attention. And I still don't know how to get at the mechanism of attention. But all of us and everybody else working in the field is looking at the effects of attention with the hope that by some retrospective entrance we may reveal what the mechanism of attention is. That so far has not been very successful. But in this case, attention has an effect strikingly different from the effect of attention in the classical visual system, in that it suppresses responses to the object fixated and facilitates the responses to objects in the periphery of the receptive of the visual field. And this accounts for the flow fields. This is the afferent input to your brain which you use when you drive an automobile down the highway, or which in earlier times people landed airplanes by the seat of their pants, lining up the symmetrical flow of images in the periphery of the visual fields as you drive or as you approach a landing field. And this, of course, has been taken up by many people in experimental psychology, and a great deal is known, first by a man named Johansson in Sweden many, many years ago, studying the flow fields. Well, that's a subject of great interest, and I pursued that for many years. It went very slowly. I was blessed with a fantastically wonderful group of colleagues that came to work with me during those years, among them Carlos Acuna from Santiago in Spain, Hideo Sakata from Japan, Jim Lynch, who's now in Missouri, and a number of others in Mississippi that brought to that endeavor many skills which I did not have at that time. And it was a true collaboration. The application of the combined experiment in the studies which I pursued was stimulated, of course, by the previous work of Herbert Jasper and Ed Everts. Ed Everts had perfected the technique for the study of the motor cortex, and we copied many of his methods and ideas. What we had to add to that was a control of the stimulus, of the sensory stimulus and of the motor response. And I've already described how we did that for the reach and manipulation neurons. In order to study the several classes of visual neurons in the parietal lobe, we devised methods which were easy to do. That is, we used back projection screens, we used boards with large numbers of light-emitting diodes on them, and under computer control we could control the visual stimuli delivered to the animal. And this, of course, has been elaborated in great detail by Wirtz and his colleagues at NIH, and very effective program of research. But this way, we were able to study the saccade neurons and the slowly tracking neurons and the light sensitive or visual neurons, if you like. And we went through several series of techniques for doing that, some of which I've illustrated in papers which I have published. But the interesting thing about all this is that it led me to the idea that the parietal lobe might sit in sort of a command relation to behavior, particularly with its projections to the pre-central motor areas. And I pursued that in detail and read about it, and I found that there was a wonderful quotation from Warren McCullough, a person whose name is not very well known now, but he said once that command will reside in that region in the brain which contains the most important and relevant information at the time. That was a very interesting thing to me, because it's actually true. If you think about the things which drive behavior, take anger, take aggression, take hunger, thirst, these things are driven from not one single command region in the highest portion of the cerebral cortex, but in certain particular places which contain the most important and driving activity at the time. So I had the idea that the parietal lobe might sit in such a command position at times, but not at other times. If you are attracted to an object and reach for it, the command might begin first in the parietal lobe. Well, there's some arguments about latencies of onset and that kind of thing. There certainly is a small class of parietal neurons that discharge very early, early before saccades, early before tracts, early before reaches. Whether they discharge before or nearly simultaneously with the activity of neurons in the premotor areas is a subject of discussion. If you think about a distributed system, of all these linked together in a distributed system, the latencies to onset become not so important. It's the web and woof, the flow of activity within the system that is important. But certainly it's true that commands do not arise for behavior in one particular location in the brain. I think that's an important generality, which almost everyone would now agree. I would not like to pretend that in this work we solved any of the major problems in the parietal lobe, but it did lead to a whole host of ideas, some of which I've expressed in some reviews I've written. That is, particularly the idea of the distributed system. I think this is an important concept. It isn't wholly my own, but I have emphasized it and written a good deal about it. The general idea that the brain is not a hierarchical system, that the brain is divided into local modular regions which differ in size and defined by different parameters in different regions of the brain, and these are heavily interconnected with modules in other regions of the brain, so that when you get inside, when you go into the brain beyond the input funnels of the primary sensory areas, or if you go back into the brain from the primary motor areas, you reach a region in which hierarchy doesn't make any sense. These regions are so heavily interconnected with each other and dynamically active all the time. So what goes on between the primary display of the world in a sensory area and your perception of it involves the whole brain. Not in any non-specific way. These regions are highly specifically interconnected. And one of the intriguing problems of the future is to work out what the activity within this distributed system means. It is often said that neuroscience is a field that is data rich and theory poor. Of course, that's a lot better than being the reverse. Nevertheless, it is true that we all work by the seat of our pants in terms of theory. I would say that I am not a theorist, but I do try to synthesize. And after my work on the columnar organization, after the work on the parietal lobe was going well, I tried to put together my ideas about columnar organization and distributed systems in a review which appeared in two places, in one of Frank Schmidt's publications and in a small volume which Frank put together called The Mindful Brain, which he backed essays by myself and by Professor Gerald Edelman. He did so virtually without our permission and without any consultation. I'll tell you something about that in a moment. But nevertheless, I was stimulated to do that not only by my own work, but by what I regard as a breakthrough discovery by Tom Powell. What Tom Powell showed, and which has been confirmed in extenso by other people, is that beneath any small patch of peel surface, there resides exactly the same number of neurons. Even though the cortex packing density is different and the thickness may be different, the number is the same in every region of the brain and every mammal, except for the striate cortex of primates, where there are twice as many. But it's the same everywhere in primate visual cortex. So I put this together with my own ideas about columnar organization, my own ideas about distributed systems, in an essay which I titled The Unit Module and the Distributed System, and it was published in these two places. And I guess I put more brain work into that essay than any other one I've ever written, because I was trying to synthesize what I thought about the general organization of the neocortex. And I've persisted in that in a private way ever since, and I'm writing about it again now. And I believe that to stand back from one's own research work and to explore in detail the research work of other people and try to put together all those ideas in a synthesis of what you think about a major subject like the function of the neocortex is not only fun, it's a responsibility. When one does something like that and puts together in a synthetic way all one's ideas and using the work of many other people as well, you obviously run into people who think that's a great idea, a few, and many people who think, oh, we knew that all already, Vernon, or other people who think, oh, that's all nonsense. That's immaterial to me. I don't really care whether people are critical of those things or not, unless they contribute something by their criticism. I'm absolutely immune to that. It doesn't affect me at all. It doesn't put me down. At one time in my career, did I stopped working on columnar organization and abandoned it for several years because of the criticism of the idea by my immediate colleagues. In 1959, I turned to other things. I did not pursue the study of columnar organization for many years. So that excessive criticism can be harmful. I learned from that experience not to pay any attention to it. Now, at that time, that essay was published in a little book called The Mindful Brain, back to back with an essay, purely theoretical essay by Professor Gerald Edelman. And it is of some interest how that arose. You know that I was for many years a member of the neuroscience research program, directed and led by that wonderful person, Frank Schmidt from MIT. And this will show you what we all thought of Frank Schmidt. He called me up one day and he said, Vernon, meet me in New York. I didn't say why, I said where. That tells a lot about what I thought of Frank Schmidt. He said, meet me in Jerry Edelman's office. So I went there. I had known Jerry through NRP casually, but not well. And I spent the whole day talking with him. And it was one of the most thrilling scientific days of my life, because I met a man filled with ideas. He told me he had read 25,000 pages of neurophysiology to prepare for his transition into neuroscience. And I can tell you, I don't think he forgot a single one of them. He had read everything I've ever written and remembered it and thought about it. That small book, titled The Mindful Brain, a title which Edelman thought of, had mixed reviews. I think that most of the reviews were very favorable. There were one or two that were critical, particularly of the sparseness with which the theory was presented. But subsequent to that, you can see in the series of publications, both in papers with colleagues and in his books by Professor Edelman, how the theory has grown, how it's elaborated, how it's become richer, has been supported by experimental and modeling observations. And whether or not the theory, Edelman's theory, is correct or not is almost unimportant. It stimulated thinking and modeling and theorizing the parts of many people. Of course, it was not the only thing stimulating that, but it was a major factor, I think. And his books, if you read them carefully, are extremely stimulating. They're filled with ideas, with theories and ideas, and he is a man who isn't at all afraid to float a new idea. And that's a stimulating thing. Now, I'm not at all afraid to float a new idea either, but I usually do it from some experimental background. I'm not a theorist, I'm not a modeler, but I am a synthesizer, and I like to put things together to think about not just that little particular region I'm recording from, but how that fits into the overall pattern of activity of the brain. And that's what I'm trying to do in my retirement and the books that I'm writing now. And I've enjoyed it because it's allowed me to synthesize knowledge obtained not only from my own work, largely from the work of other people in this field, and to bring it together and to try to lay out in extenso what we know about the function of the cerebral cortex. And it turns out that what we know about the function of the cerebral cortex is very little. We know a great deal about the structure of the cerebral cortex, about connectivity within it, about its anatomy, but we know very little about the dynamic activity within the cerebral cortex. And I think this is a great secret. We need to discover what the intrinsic operation within a module of the cortex is. And that is, we absolutely don't know. I always thought that we could learn that by looking at the input and the output and by retrospective reconstruction, learn something about what the intrinsic operation is, but that has not been successful. Some approaches made in the visual cortex, probably it's the most advanced state of knowledge, and I've got a whole chapter on that. Those people have done very well indeed, but still the great mysteries remain. And we call visual cortex visual largely because it receives input from the eye, not because of an intrinsic visual thing there. There's nothing intrinsically visual or intrinsically sensory or intrinsically motor about those areas of the cortex. So there we have an opportunity for a generalizing hypothesis. That is, that while there may be elaborations that are different in different areas, there'll be some basic operation that is similar everywhere. We haven't the slightest idea what that operation is. That, I think, is the central problem for one of the central problems for the future of neurophysiology, is to discover what the intrinsic operation of the cerebral cortex is. And I think it can be done now with modern methods that are available. So that the idea of the column is much more important than the fact that it's a vertically linked group of cells. And the second aspect of it that is important is because of the fantastic intracortical connectivity that's been discovered by anatomists. So now we can think of the brain as being a set of modules distributed all across the cortex, interconnected in a very heavily way, and constituting distributed systems. And this fits with developing ideas and theories about how sensory input is processed. It's not processed in this look and this look, but in a distributed system. That raises even greater problems, because what's looking at distributed systems? And we have the danger of an infinite regress there. It doesn't solve the problem, but it sets the problem. And I think that if I were a young man, I would begin to work on that, at this preconscious distributed processing in the brain, which leads to perception, and from perception leads to motor action. And one of the secrets of great success, of success in science, is to choose a problem which has at least some significant probability of success. And I don't believe that we're going to discover the brain mechanisms of consciousness in the immediate future, but we will learn a great deal about these higher order processing levels in sensation and perception and in the organization of effort and activity leading to movement. And this is the thing for the next 10 or 15 years. And it can be worked on with newly developed methods of multiple microelectrode chronic implantation. And that's the wave of the future. The notion of the distributed system actually comes from engineering science. There's a formal definition in a paper by a man named Lamport from MIT 20 years or so ago. And his definition is that a distributed system consists of nodes that are separated separately, that communicate with each other by exchanging messages, and that the exchange time is some significant fraction of the intranodal processing time. That fits very well with the interaction between modules within the cortex, where the transmission time between nodes, say in the parietal lobe and the frontal lobe, is a very significant fraction of intramodular operations, which might be 10 milliseconds or so. And conduction velocity in the fibers connecting those regions are relatively slow. So it fits very well. One of the great mysteries is that in the theoretic definition of a distributed system requires the presence of a real-time clock. And no one has yet discovered a real-time clock in the nervous system. And as Francis Crick has said, that would be a major discovery. I doubt if it's going to be discovered, but nevertheless, there the problem resides. So that a distributed system contains a number of nodes. In the cerebral cortex, it's usually a relatively large number of nodes, but there can be subsystems in which they're smaller. And these are dynamically active, receiving afferent input, exchanging signals between nodes, raising and lowering their level of activity depending upon the dynamic input and what's required of them. Any one of these particular nodes may be a member from time to time in different distributed systems because of their different connections to different areas. So you see, the problem gets more and more complicated. The way to approach that scientifically is to try to isolate in the behavior you test one particular distributed system and to analyze the nodes of that system simultaneously. And that's why I think the somatic motor interface is a very fine system to pursue, and it is being pursued by people like Caminiti and Laquaniti in Italy and others who will, I think, in the future attempt to record simultaneously in the motor component of the distributed system and the parietal lobe component of the distributed system. And that will be a wonderful experiment to do. One could do that by chronic implantation of electrodes in, say, the premotor cortex or the supplementary motor cortex and in the parietal lobe and look simultaneously at the events going on within this distributed system as an animal projects his arm to a target or whether he performs a motor task of any kind. That would be a very exciting thing to do. And I think the techniques for doing that are developing, particularly as we mentioned a few moments ago, the evolving technique of the chronic implantation of many microelectrodes in waking behaving non-human primates. Corollary with this, there is a huge area developing of imaging the human brain during sensory and perceptual and motor performances. And these will be correlated and parallel programs of research in many of the major labs in the world in the next decades. The work in the human beings will reveal a great deal of many answers to questions which begin with where, geographic questions. And those are important questions because they're already revealing new geographic facts. For example, if a human works in a somatic sensory task, regions are activated in his brain which include those we would predict, like the postcentral gyrus, but many others as well that we would not predict. That's an interesting new thing, and it gives leads for experiments in non-human primates. So these will be parallel and interacting programs of research, I think, for many years to come. And they involve what I have called a transition from seat of your pants neurophysiology to big science. Neuroscience is becoming big science, and it requires big support. It requires collaborative work of people with many skills and training and background for its success. And that's going to evolve, and I think it is evolving in the major laboratories in the world. I'd point out the wonderful development at Queen's Square in London of between Zeki working in the neuroanatomical and neurophysiological side and Frank Koviak and his colleagues working on the imaging side. And they now are co-directors, you know, of that entire program there. What a marvelous idea of bringing together simultaneous work in waking non-human primates and in humans on essentially the same sets of problems. And that, I think, is a wave of the future, and they're achieving it there. I think I look forward to tremendous discoveries made by that group there. So those are some of the things that I would predict for the future. I think that there is a fantastic opportunity. We now can really study. We're now just up to speed. Research of the last two or three decades has provided a background on which young people can spring, from which they can spring. And we can begin to study in detail, in a hard-nosed, objective, scientific way, the brain mechanisms of higher functions. And that's a rather thrilling prospect. One of the secrets of successful science, at least in my own experience, is to choose problems for which there is at least some positive fractional probability of success. I do not believe that we will solve the problems of consciousness in the immediate term future, but what we will do is learn a great deal about all those complicated processes in the brain that lead up to, for example, your conscious perception. But the secret of consciousness, within the secret of consciousness, there is some great mystery, some principle that we've not yet discovered. And I put it this way to say, how can we learn how a brain comes to inspect itself? That's a deep problem. It's a deep philosophical problem, an extremely difficult experimental problem, for which I think we've not yet got the tools.